Over the last several videos, we've been learning about acids and bases and how the pH influences their speciation, especially when we're thinking about diprotic and polyprotic acids. And all of these ideas are really important in helping us understand the chemistry of amino acids. So you may recognize the word amino acid because they're the building blocks of proteins. So they're the single units that build up a protein. And proteins are kind of like these, they're beads on a chain, and these individual beads are amino acids. So as the name suggests, amino acids have an amine group as well as a more acidic group. So the only real requirement for an amino acid is for it to have an amine and for it to have a carboxylic acid. So the simplest amino acid would have these two attached directly to each other. But in reality, most amino acids in your body, at least the ones that we really care about, have the amine group attached to the carboxylic acid through a single extra carbon. And we call this carbon the alpha carbon. It's called the alpha carbon because it's one position away from the carbonyl, right? So this is our carbonyl carbon, the one with the double bond. So the next carbon over is the alpha carbon. If we were to create a longer chain here, if we had another carbon or another carbon, then this would be the beta carbon. It's two positions away. This would be the gamma carbon, three positions away. Okay, but none of these are especially important right now. The only thing that really matters is this general architecture of amino acids. And that was our alpha carbon. We're going to see in subsequent videos that what's attached to this alpha carbon gives individual amino acids their properties. But for now, let's focus in on the acid-base chemistry of the amine group and the carboxylic acid. Okay, so each of these two functional groups have pKa values. They're within an experimental range. So amines tend to have pKas in the 9 range. So for this example, we're going to say that this amino group has a pKa of 9, and the carboxylic acid has a pKa that's much more acidic, and that's down in the 3 range. So what we want to do now is think about just very much in general, what a titration curve would look like as we're thinking about a diprotic acid, so H2X, as we change the pH and we have pKas of 3 and pKas of 9. So this is something we've seen before, right? We know that we have this diprotic acid that starts acidic, and we're going to reach the first half equivalence point, and that's going to be where the pH equals 3. That's the first pKa, the most acidic pKa. We're going to reach the equivalence point, and that's where we have the average of these two pKas. So it's going to be 9 plus 3 over 2. So we expect the pH of the equivalence point to be 6. And then at the second half equivalence point, or the 3/2 point, this is where the pH equals the second pKa, so that's 9. And then at the second equivalence point, that's going to be up much more basic. So the general shape of this is going to be something that looks like this. Right? And each of these points, the first half equivalence point, the equivalence point, and the second half equivalence point, are really easy to predict. Okay, so now let's think about what these chemical species might be at different pHs. So we've learned about speciation curves. So let's go ahead and sketch one out here. We know that on these speciation curves, we want to mark the half equivalence point, the first equivalent point, the 3/2 point, and the second equivalence point. Okay, so let's start off in red here. So red is going to be my H2X. This is the fully protonated form, And we know that we're under really acidic pHs, we have 100% of the fully protonated form. And this is going to fall off and reach the 50% point at the first half equivalence point, right? Because we know that at the first half equivalence point, this is where we have 50% H2X, and we'll have 50% of the monoprotonated form HX. So we drop off, and by the first equivalence point, we have essentially a concentration of zero of our fully protonated. Okay, we'll make purple the HX form. We know at the beginning we have zero HX because we have 100% H2X. But by the time we get to the half equivalence point, we have 50% HX. And by the time we get to the first equivalence point, we have 100% HX. But this concentration starts dropping off as we move, right? So as we move past the first equivalence point to the second half equivalence point, the three halves point, now we are converting HX to the fully deprotonated form X. So by the time we reach the three halves point, we should be at 50%, and we should be at 0% by the time we reach the second equivalence point. So this shape is kind of a bell curve. It's maximized when H2X is minimized, and then we start losing as we start gaining the fully deprotonated. So we'll show the fully deprotonated in yellow. So X here is going to be the deprotonated form. We have none of this up until the first equivalence point. But once we've reached the first equivalence point, we've reached the equilibrium between HX and the deprotonated form. So this is where this starts to increase. By the 3 halves point, we have 50%. By the second equivalence point, we've completely converted our acid to the fully deprotonated form that is X. Okay, so what we just showed here really shouldn't be especially surprising because we've seen the titration curve and the speciation curve for diprotic acids before. We know that the pH at the first half equivalence point is 3 because that's the first pKa. So this pH would be 3. We know the pH at the second half equivalence point should be 9 because that's the pH of the second pKa, or that's the second pKa. And the pH at the first equivalence point will be the average of the two. And we can think about the chemical speciation based on these pHs. Okay, so keep this in mind because in the next video, we're going to start with this speciation curve and use it to help us understand the charges of the amino acid as we transition from really acidic pHs to really basic pHs. Okay, so keep this speciation curve handy.